Launching process. Begin. Phase 2. Activate. Keep all ears, all eyes, all mouths to screen. You will be brainwashed.
I want to show you something.
Welcome to the phase 2 of Brainwatching. I am your host, Nintles, and today we have Jay Chippers.
Hello.
We have Wildcard.
Wait, what happened to phase 1?
We finished phase 1.
Why are there phases?
It's not a phase, Mom.
And we also have Cubicle Wings.
I'm still alive.
And joining us for the first time, our brand new secondary member, Poptimus.
Yeah.
I'm never going to be knocked off this.
Just introduce the man, it's time for me to shoot him.
It's okay, my coffee desk is just an L bracket, or my desk is just an, like a coffee table that I L bracketed onto my old desk legs. It looks, yes, it looks fine. Unless you see the.
I mean, that could have passed as a good shot. And popped it. Okay, there we go.
All right, so let's start this podcast with the latest news about Pokemon Sword and Shield.
Ooh.
It's coming.
It's coming, boys.
Who would have thought? A new Pokemon game. What was it, that CNN or whatever it was, the article talking about Nintendo breathing life to old properties by releasing a Pokemon game?
That.
And Nintendo blows them all away by releasing a new Pokemon game. This just in, they're bringing Mario back. God.
Fucking new Pokemon game set in fucking Europe.
That'd actually be kind of cool just to go around and, you know, make new Pokemon games based in new locations and just kind of learn about the world through Pokemon. Yeah, that'd be really cool.
Because the first few games were all just, you know, Japanese regions.
Yeah.
Are these actual Japanese regions, or are they mythical regions that...
No, they're actual fucking Japanese regions.
Well, I know Kanto is. I don't know. I'm pretty... Is Johto one? Is Johto?
It's based off
actual
region. Well, there is an actual Kanto region of Japan.
Yeah.
That's true.
I'm saying, like, the Johto region is based on a region in Japan. Yeah. It's just not the name.
Yeah.
But same with Galar for this one. It's actually like
Scotland?
Scotland and Britain and
North Ireland. Maybe
Scotland is part of Britain.
It is part of the United Kingdom, yes.
It's literally just based on the UK in general.
Like, yeah, that's what I was about to ask. Is it gonna be like
Because
the Pokemon Scottish and the Pokemon, you know, English gonna be in a rivalry, or, you know, each other call each other wankers, or
Pokemon battles are basically glorified tea times.
Yes.
Dude, seeing the fan comics for this shit is so fucking funny.
I have not seen much.
Hearing the girl speak Scottish, like very violent Scottish.
Oh, I try it, but I embarrass myself.
But I love this new concept, though.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they've been doing more like outside of Japan kind of regions since
I'd be very interested to see them getting into more obscure, you know, less known regions, like, you know, the Chilean region or the, you know, Nicaraguan region.
Don't you dare drop the N-word on this podcast.
Purposefully.
Oh, boy.
Okay, but anyways,
you're lucky this isn't live.
Yeah, you know what? I'll pick another African nation. Chad, the Chad region.
Chad region. They've been doing these kind of regions since X and Y, because X and Y was based in France,
yeah.
And what was it? Sun and Moon was based in Hawaii.
Yeah.
Well, Hawaii and Philippines, kind of. It's kind of weird.
Disappoints me because something so bright and vibrant as the cultures of Hawaii got the most like bland Pokemon game. Probably the most
boring,
only one I've not finished, and I just don't really.
Yes, Sun and Moon was the most handheld game.
Yeah.
I don't mean that by like the system. I mean like they hold your hand through the entire game.
Like it just feels like on rails, and it's so weird that it's like they give you this idea, this fake idea that, oh man, all the 3D models are bigger, everybody looks bigger and it looks more open, but in reality it's just like all the routes are just like tunnel, like, you know, they're like mazes. There's no like open expansion. It's so bland. And like the opening to the game, the first 40 minutes is just makes me want to rip my teeth out.
Yeah. it's weird though with Sword and Shield. It's using a mix of models from Sun and Moon and the Pokemon Let's Go.
Yeah.
It's so off-putting. But like the reason, like the Pokemon models, the Pokemon models, they pulled that straight out from X and Y though. They've been used because they just do some touch ups basically.
Yeah.
Cube.
Well, not X and Y. Sun and Moon is what it was. Yeah. What?
You still live there, Cube?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay.
See, I think my biggest concern with the new Sword and Shield is the fact that it's like going on Switch is a no-brainer, but that kind of means that it's going to be a full-priced game.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of wondering now that it's on an actual like console, because the Switch does pack like a surprising amount of power, at least much more than the 3DS does.
Yeah.
So. Because I'm just trying to think, like, are they going to do enough to realistically constitute that big increase? Because I'm just thinking, like, here in Canada, I could buy both versions, and I'd be paying, like, maybe $100. And, like, for two games and getting the exclusive, and I love Pokemon, that's great. But now it's, like, $160 for me to buy both versions.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just hoping, like, it adapts.
Like, I mean...
With it being on the DS, it's always been like, you know, $40, but now it's going to be like probably like $60 to $80.
Hopefully they at least make it bigger compensate for that.
Yeah.
I mean, the Switch in general is like we're re-entering the golden age of Nintendo here. So
That or they could probably do like a DLC expansion pack for each version. So like, for example, you get Sword, you could download an expansion of Shield that costs like considerably less than the base
game.
The thing with expansion in Pokemon is that they just like to make entirely new games, which is basically the same game just with expanded story. I mean, you see that with fucking Black 1 and Black 2, and
okay, but Black 2
Pokemon Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon were basically the same exact games.
See, Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon, I've looked in Ultra Sun, Ultra Moon, and I do know they don't change late enough. To be fair, though, I will give them credit. Pokemon Black and White 2 are, like, how you do a Pokemon, like, actual sequel.
Yeah.
Like, the trails are different. They add, like, they mix up the Pokemon, the gym leaders. They continue the story in a cool way.
Yeah.
Like, for sequels, they're real. I am just a Gen 5, like, fanboy.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I love Gen 5. It's actually my favorite Gen. Like,
yeah, Gen 5 is, like, literally, like, the best Pokemon's ever been. It just accompanies so much of what's good. And people are just sticklers because, one or two bad Pokemon designs.
Fucking trash Pokemon.
Have you seen the fairy types? Have you seen the unholy monstrosity that is Slurmpuff? Or Klefki?
And think about, like, the first few Pokemon from the...
I am so behind on Pokemon, I need to...
Okay, look up Slurmpuff.
I'm doing it right now.
Let me just hear this live reaction. I'll pull it.
And then, like, the first few generations of Pokemon...
Sorry, Slurpuff.
Like, the first few generations of Pokemon weren't that good either.
That's the Futurama version.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I'm just, like, I'm worried, because... I'm hoping they do enough to adapt it, because the region kind of looks surprisingly kind of bland as far as big islands go. It just kind of, I don't know.
I'm hoping the
city changes my opinion and it's like a mega city that blows you away with how big it is. Otherwise, it looks.
It looks more open world than, you know, than, I mean, yeah, the first part of it is, you know, just a set path.
Wait, what was the second Pokemon?
As all Pokemon games are.
Klefki.
Klefki, yeah.
With a K, so Klefki.
The fucking key Pokemon.
Here, I can just send you...
What? What?
Yeah, it's a keychain. It's a key fob there.
It's
just...
Okay, I mean, I thought this was like some kind of... It looks like kind of the ring from... The keys from Fairy Tail. Yeah, that's a bit.
I mean, people are diehard fans of Klefki, so I avoid.
Yeah. Like Gen 5 is pretty
good. I'm probably going to post them on this video, so.
Yeah. But,
yeah, I'm just pulling up stupid Pokemon designs.
I mean, like.
But,
I'm so. Like, I've kind of stopped after Gen 2, so I'm way behind on.
And that's fair. Like. As Nidtos told me, like, this will be his first Pokemon game that he's actually ever gonna probably get.
So I've never actually, like, I owned a DS, but I haven't played the Pokemon games on a handheld console because I usually prefer playing console Nintendo games.
I'm an appliance type trainer.
Rotom. Rotom's good. Okay, but, let me show you my favorite.
The fucking dishwasher.
I will show you my favorite boy.
Because this is the first Pokemon, the official first Pokemon game to be on a home console. Well, technically, it's also on a portable console because, you know, Nintendo Switch.
Like something from a.
This actually is
like a fantasy game or something. I don't know. God
damn it, wild card.
It's like giving a brand new opportunity for like brand new fans to come into the franchise, and you know that's the one thing I really like.
Yeah.
Yeah, because like, buying the old Nintendo like handhelds can be iffy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I honestly don't know if what I'm looking at here are actual Pokemon.
They are. That's Alolan Dugtrio. That is a real one.
Oh my god!
This art. Shoutouts to
his hair is supposed. His hair is supposed to be steel, and it doesn't make sense. I don't fucking know, but like
Surfer Dugtrios.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Now let's actually talk about the topic. You know.
No, we're getting distracted, and we're happy about it.
The topic, Pokemon's going downhill.
Yeah, fuck, no. It's supposed to be positive.
I mean, I'm excited. I'm hoping.
From slow bro to slow no.
Let's actually talk about these starters. So,
yeah, like
Grookey Gang.
That's the only Pokemon. Those are the only original Pokemon they showed. Like all the other Pokemon that they showed was from.
Show a photo of the starters for Pokemon.
Okay, but please, I got to shout out the cameo from Soul Eater here.
God damn it.
Oh, Koffa Grievous. I love him too.
Okay, what is this? Which unit are we on now?
Show the starters, all three starters for Sword and Shield.
Okay, Sword and
It's like Grookey, Scorbunny, and...
Yeah, here we go.
Sobble. Which I think the water one could have had a better name, like, to be honest.
Sobble.
Shobble!
It's
like Sobble, but with no N.
Apparently, Sobble is supposed to...
But Sobble doesn't get the end pass.
Sobble is apparently supposed to be, he's supposed to be, this type of, like, water, salamander shit.
Yeah.
And...
What?
Scorbunny, like, okay, so these ones, these Pokemon are supposed to be based off of, like, different sports in the UK.
Interesting.
And which is really weird, because, like, Pokemon's never done, like, a straight concept for Pokemon like that. Like a theme. They've never done a theme for their starters.
I think these are predictions.
The evolutions? Oh, shoot.
No,
I think they're predictions of it.
Yeah, prediction. There's no leaks yet or reveals yet.
Those
now, these are the evolutions.
Sorry, man. I'm just gonna...
Oh, God damn it. God damn it.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. Cube, do you like Pokemon? Yeah.
Kinda. I don't really play them all that much. I think the last Pokemon game I played was Pokemon, like, Pearl on the DS.
That's not bad. Like,
I think that was like the only Pokemon game I played.
I never got Diamond. Fuck Diamond.
I want to get Platinum just because it's like it's actually kind of slightly faster than the other.
Yeah, Platinum's good. Platinum's actually good. But it's that gen Sinnoh is like the slowest gen though.
Yeah.
And that's saying something when you compare it to the first games.
Yeah,
like
real tall.
Like Sinnoh's super fucking slow. but I'm actually super excited for this new game. Because it takes new elements, it takes old elements from the recent Pokemon spin-offs and Sun and Moon, and the design the logo itself could look better, like the dog shield and the dog sword.
Oh.
look kind of stupid, to be honest. Just a dog head on a sword and then a dog head on a sheep look kind of stupid.
Yeah.
Pokemon. Well, I mean, it could just have done like...
Is this a Pokemon?
This is Pokemon, let's see here. That's a Digimon. I'm triggered right now. I'm not even lying.
So yeah, I'm excited for the new Digimon game.
I'm like someone's parent. Ah, you with them Pokemans. Is that a Pikachu?
All right, so you guys finally up for the next time.
I'm excited for Pokemon Gun.
Yeah.
Yes. Pokemon Gun next expansion. All right, you guys want to talk about the next topic?
Sure.
Sure, give me something else to spam.
Okay, so let's talk about what they revealed at the Nintendo Direct that happened in February.
Oh my god. I can't. Okay. So I only remember two things from it.
Okay, so Super Mario Maker 2 was announced.
Yes.
Yay. Yes. Good. More torture chambers. Hooray.
Hooray.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of that, Ross from the Game Grumps is working for a month straight.
Yes, I love it.
Mario Maker levels.
Nice.
And he's being paid for it.
Oh, nice.
Okay. Like, he made an agreement with Aaron to just make Mario Maker levels, and that's all he would do in the office.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that he's going to get for it is nothing compared to the money they're going to make off of it. You know?
Yeah. Dude.
Like, people are going to be watching that shit so excited, you know, so religiously.
I still watch the Mario Maker.
Oh yeah, it's some of the best stuff.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But anyways, what else happened in that direct?
So they also revealed a Legend of Zelda Link's Awakening remake.
Yeah, it looked very off-putting. Not gonna lie.
Honestly, when I first saw it, I was like, oh god, it looks terrible.
I think that was kind of how Wind Waker was received.
Yeah.
Just because it looks so different.
Yeah. Wind Waker,
it just looks different.
It looks super good now when you look at it. But, everyone was shocked back
then.
Well,
that's because they were advertising to go the way kind of where Twilight Princess went, where it looked really, really polished and really good aesthetically.
Yeah, Breath of the Wild got that reception.
Wind Waker off. Yeah, and then they dropped Wind Waker on everybody, and they're like, "What the fuck? No, this is not what you told us."
Yeah, Wind Waker got that. Breath of the Wild got the reception too.
Yeah,
because people were expecting it to be like the tech demo they showed off, but then it was
exactly
shaded.
I mean, to be honest, I loved the realistic models compared to the other Zelda models. To be honest, I love the
I did too. Honestly, Breath of the Wild models, the
Twilight
Princess models,
those are and even Hyrule Warriors looks not that bad.
Yeah.
Speaking of those warrior games, they also showed off Fire Emblem Three Houses.
I
Harry Potter.
It's not. It's not going to do as good as the other. Awakening. Yeah.
The thing I was actually thinking about when I was actually seeing Three Houses. It reminded me a lot of Harry Potter and how they actually...
Harry Potter and the Date Your Teacher.
Harry Potter and the Waifu Simulator.
I mean, yeah.
I mean, it's...
Harry Potter and the what?
It's the first Fire Emblem game I'm actually, considering getting.
Yeah.
Get Awakening. Awakening's great.
I don't know. That one has to... See, I'm just looking at this one, and I'm just thinking, there doesn't seem to be as many Marths in this one, so...
God damn it.
Well, I mean, we got, five Marths in Smash already. It's hard, I gotta take a breather.
Here you go, Jeff.
They also showed off Tetris 99, which is a free game on Switch.
People are playing that crazy right now.
Oh, it's a great fucking game. Oh my god.
Oh, people play that religiously now. It looks addicting. I wouldn't get it, but it looks addicting.
Oh, it is. It's basically the perfect format for the whole Battle Royale craze, because basically it's just Tetris. And
what?
It works perfectly.
I mean, if you've seen the recent Tetris games, it was all leading up to this where they wanted to do multiple players. Now they have 99 players. But yeah, what else happened? Fucking
Astro Chain. Platinum Games is back with Astral Chain. Dude, I don't even care if Bayonetta 3 is not coming out this year. Astral Chain is going to be pleasing my appetite.
It doesn't look that bad.
That's an insane phrase.
It's not something I would get, but like, it doesn't look that bad.
I think it's being done by the director of... I think the designer, producer of Nier Automata.
Oh.
Yeah, so... Yeah. And also the guy that does the whole Bayonetta series. Yeah, under the supervision of Hideki Kamiya.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That blocks then, a lot of people on Twitter.
And then Hunter, what was the one you said?
Daemon X Machina.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That,
I played the demo. The only bad thing is they really need to optimize it, but
oh, yeah.
I'm so ready.
I played a bit of it. It's okay. it definitely feels like what I wanted Xenoblade Chronicles X to be, and that was driving mecha-based combat. Instead of, take you 30 hours to get into your skell, and then it will take you 30 more hours to get, like, the ability to fly.
See, that's just
fuck,
the trick.
I hate
just...
Xenoblade Chronicles X.
That's why you just play Xenoblade 1 and just forget about the rest.
Yeah. Xenoblade 1 is like superior to everything else.
Just don't play on the Wii U. Just don't play on the Wii.
One of my favorite games. Yeah. Well, look, honestly, I'm glad that like I got to take a look into the Simu there, the like, Wii U emulator. Yeah, I'm not buying a Wii U again, and I'm sorry. Like, nah, dog.
It's old.
Yeah.
I sold mine before the Switch even came out. I was like, nah. Not even for Smash.
And also, they talked about Marvel Ultimate Alliance 3, which is actually, I'm really excited for, because it's an exclusive Marvel game, which is good.
Yeah, that doesn't look that bad. What else happened?
I think that's about it. They didn't really.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. We should also talk about the elephant in the room. Nintendo Labo is getting a VR kit.
Getting what?
Wait, what?
They are getting a VR kit.
Oh.
Oh yeah, that.
Believe me, I really know. I work for Labo Man. All Labo the Labo Man. Sets.
Yeah.
Like every single one of them. He
has everything.
Yeah.
He
is actually Labo Man. He will pull it out and get ready to fight you in the
elephants.
But no, like
this is like, I don't think, wait, is this real?
No.
What?
No, here.
The Nintendo Labo or
this would be a good one if it was.
No, it's just shit he's spamming.
My thoughts on the Nintendo Labo VR kit. I could definitely say that the specs of the Nintendo Switch are not really VR ready, especially that screen they have. It's like a 720p screen. But I'm hoping in the future they will have like a legit VR headset for Nintendo Switch. But
so you're saying the screen of the Switch is not set for?
It's like 720p.
Labo? Or VR?
It's like 720p, dude. It won't really be that good.
I mean, yeah, but we can do it with our phones too, so.
Yeah, but most phones are like 4K screens, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's the thing. As advanced as the Switch is, it still has its limitations. Like,
yeah.
But honestly, it doesn't look bad. The VR set doesn't look bad.
Yeah. I think it's just like a good testing the waters for Nintendo.
It looked definitely...
Labo itself, just weird.
Yeah.
It's pretty fun. I've played around with it. It can be fun. If you're that kind of person that's very like...
It's super expensive though for fucking cardboard, you know?
Jeez. Like, have you guys seen Donkey? Video game Donkey? This video on Labo?
Wow, I'm not sure who that YouTube creator is.
Where he just gets and starts playing with the box it came in instead of the actual stuff.
God damn it.
Go watch it. Actually, you know what? No, let me pull up right now.
I mean, that's honestly, like, you could just make the Labo sets yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like, the beauty of Labo is because you can, like, some people have 3D printed, like, versions of it and stuff. It's basically like building blocks.
Watch someone make a Mario Kart out of fucking Labo. And play Mario Kart with it.
Make an actual functioning car with cardboard. And, you know, play Mario Kart with it.
The VR set was very off-putting at first when I first saw it. I thought it was fake.
Yeah.
But, the Labo announcement?
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
It looks...
But it also, I mean, I see the logic to it. It's just not good logic in this case. Like,
yeah,
when everybody's going VR, going the opposite direction of everyone else is not always usually not a bad idea. But in this case, they went a little too hard against everyone else, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, for a first step, I think it's good because the Nintendo Switch doesn't have the specs to have like very hardcore VR games. So I think in this case, until they get like a new model or they develop like a legitimate headset for Nintendo Switch, I think this is a good stepping stone.
Mm-hmm.
This is something to just like test the waters on like VR development and stuff like that. So
yeah, that's the thing. Nintendo is like the only company that's like really behind on that.
Behind on what? I'm sorry?
Like, Nintendo's the only gaming company that's like really behind on that
on
with
VR.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
PlayStation has some involvement with VR. Not good, but like.
I feel like Nintendo's kind of at that point where, like, I'm always really. Like, the Vive and stuff and all the VR shit, it looks cool. But, like, at the end of the day, it hasn't really done, like, in my opinion, enough to constitute, like, how like, expensive of a just...
It's overhyped.
It is. Like, yeah, I think Nintendo realizes, like, we kind of have our own market that we're kind of dipping our feet into, where it's, like, with VR, it's like, oh, cool, you can pay, like, full motion VR chat. And like Beat Saber and Super Hot, and that's about the only like extent of games that are decent for it.
Yeah,
and the rest are just like basically shovelware games that do the same thing.
Yeah,
yeah.
They just need to put more into it, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
But they're trying to pull money out of it without actually putting money into it, and that, as a business model, just doesn't work.
Yeah, it's just a bit more development needs to be done.
Yeah.
I feel it's like even worth playing.
Yeah.
If it gives you an experience that's equal to playing an actual video game where half the time it isn't because you're limited due to the controller interface. So
anyways, you want to go to the next topic?
Before we do, I want to comment on the direct. I was going to say that fucking no Animal Crossing news. Makes me very mad.
Just put a leaf.
No, I need news about the new Animal Crossing game.
They're just gonna put same events into a new, like, same game.
The fact that they were able to turn paying mortgage into a video game is astounding.
I respect Animal Crossing, but I was like,
most people play video games to escape the real world, not simulate it. You know?
I think I had like 60 hours on like New Leaf, and then I was like, you know what? I got Animal Crossing. That's fine.
I was gonna say,
I was gonna pay my rent, but then he was like, no, you know what? I got Animal Crossing. I'm covered.
I was gonna say, weren't they making that iPhone game? And then I remembered, yeah, they did made an iPhone game.
Yeah, yeah.
You remember the party game?
Oh yeah, the party game. The one where people were actually faking that would be like the killer app for the Wii U, and then they announced it was an Amiibo festival.
Yeah.
Oh god, it was for the Wii U.
To be honest, if it wasn't so Amiibo based, it could be a decent game.
Yeah.
Like, it's just basically a Mario Party ripoff, which
Mario
is fine.
Party, but without the fun game part of that Mario
Party. In my opinion, it was the one game that killed the Wii U.
No, a lot of things killed the Wii U.
No, but this was the death blow.
I mean, they also made
the
Star Fox
game itself to be a death blow.
Oh god, yeah, that was
not that
terrible.
Great.
Because I mean, E.T. for Atari wasn't the death blow for Atari, and it's completely it never made, so I don't think a game in itself is something that would kill a console.
Yeah, the Wii U was just a blunder in the first place.
Yeah. Wii U was just a developmental step to the Switch, I think.
Yeah.
I agree.
Anyways. But, yeah, let's move on.
Okay, so, Xbox. They will now be streaming games from any console, portable like iPhone, etc., etc., and maybe even the Switch to your device, any Xbox game to your device. I know I'm bad at words.
What he means is that the Xbox network or their storefront is basically coming to like other consoles.
Yeah.
Huh. Other devices. Like the Switch. Which I was very upset when it first broke, because as much as I love some Xbox games and I love the Switch, I don't want Xbox on my Switch. I'm fine with some games. I do not want an entire network on it.
Yeah, they said the same thing about chocolate and peanut butter, and what happened with when they actually mixed it? They got rays.
Yeah. I don't know. I just, like, I'm thinking with especially the news that was recently announced, that I won't say it because I'm sure it's going to come up, hopefully, possibly, is that the reasons for buying Xbox One is so fucking, like, shriveling up. Yeah. I think Xbox kind of realizes it.
So well, no.
Why they're playing nice ball.
No, I think what's happening is, I mean, in general, consoles, when they develop consoles, they make them at a loss. Like, they make them hoping that you'll buy games for them, and they'll make the money in the games, not the consoles themselves.
Yeah.
So they're trying to cut out the consoles in general to make it to where they don't have to continue developing at a loss and continue just
That's what Sega's done over the years. They dropped out of the console game a long time ago, and they're still making like
bad games,
decent games.
And they're still murdering the Hedgehog.
Most of the games that they've made that have been somewhat decent were only published by them. They were not developed.
If you think
that people want an old Sonic game in the go ahead, make it. I bet it'll suck.
Yes.
Dude, Sonic Mania wasn't that bad. Like,
no, it was great.
Yeah.
I just hate Sonic games in general.
Sega, but that's the thing though. Sega is a third party company nowadays.
Yeah.
They just basically license games and put those licenses out to the developers and the consoles.
What I'm thinking what Microsoft is doing, they're basically opening up Xbox in a way that is like what they do with Windows. So instead of it being like this like DRM console that has only like closed like games on it, you can't like you have to buy a different console if you want to get someone else's exclusives. Instead, what I'm thinking they're doing is they're pulling a Steam and making it so anyone like with like any machine can access Xbox games. I think that's tapping into an untapped market, which honestly is like really smart because like there's not really that much like they're trying to destroy the competition in a way that is like we're not the monopoly, but we want to give you an opportunity to play any game that you want.
There are still games that are not inclusive on Steam itself, so I don't think that's necessarily an accurate statement. But
Steam is its own marketplace.
They also been trying like new stuff like the adaptive controller, where like basically you could make any controller that you want, and it's perfect for like people with special needs. I think that in a way is like really progressive in how like the gaming industry is, because not everyone could be playing like games with the same type of controller that everyone like normal people can be expected to. Like
there's that, there's also just the market of customization itself, you know. Like some people want a unique controller.
I'm fine with like the different games coming to coming to the Switch from Xbox and Microsoft or whatever. It's just, I mean, if Microsoft is trying to basically destroy this whole competition sort of thing that they've had for years with PlayStation and Nintendo, I guess that is progress.
See, I think they're realizing now just how good it is to play ball with Nintendo and Microsoft playing ball with each other. They're kind of realizing just like how good it's going.
Sony is the only one no fun allowed.
Sony is behind the times.
Well, that and also, you know, the concept of console wars just doesn't draw people like it used to. But there was a time when, you know, Xbox or PlayStation, you know, was a big, you know.
Yeah, but think about
point of focus.
Think about this one game that is on all the consoles now, including PC, fucking Fortnite.
Yeah,
like that was as of a game it is. It's very progressive for
crossplay and all that stuff.
Yeah, crossplay.
Yes.
Like, and same with Apex Legends. It's gonna happen.
And not only but Microsoft also owns Minecraft, so I think that is like the biggest catalyst. They own like one of the biggest games of all time, and they want to reach that to everyone.
Well, I think they realize that excluding people means excluding their money as well.
Exactly.
So they're trying to be as inclusive and cross-platform.
And this also brings into our next topic, where they're actually releasing Halo: The Master Chief Collection on Steam.
And I said this on Twitter that now I don't have to buy a shitty Xbox for it. Because like, okay, so I've been a Halo fan for years. I played up till like 4.
Mm-hmm.
And then just, I didn't want to get an Xbox One, so I just gave up.
I mean, I probably, honestly, after playing 4, I wasn't even tempted to get an Xbox.
Yeah, 4 was kind of bad.
4 was...
I like 4.
4, I have a lot of words for. That's for sure. Oof. Oh man, that game.
It's different, but it's not bad, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But like,
the level design is very poor. It's short. They basically take away so much that makes like Halo Halo unique in the gameplay, and like,
yeah,
they add nothing of substance.
Yeah.
But honestly,
kind of, but the story, at least, sorry to get off the topic.
No.
Before, but the story is where it really excels, I think.
I don't know.
It's really the multiplayer. To be honest.
Yeah, like, Halo, the only thing I could say about Halo 4 was that I thought the multiplayer was okay.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I played, like, some Halo games from my brother because he owned an Xbox. I haven't played past 3 because I was actually one of the only people that never owned an Xbox 360. I know. Shocking.
Wow.
Nerd. Wow.
I know, it's so shocking since that console was basically the most popular console in the last generation.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely don't look to play mine again because it kind of chugs nowadays.
Yeah, like, yeah.
Yeah.
So old, but
my 360, as we speak, is literally sitting in the corner, like not even like 2 feet away from me, just collecting dust.
But no, like, I wasn't really, like, that big of an Xbox player outside the first Xbox. So this is a good way to catch up on, games I've missed. And not only that, but, Microsoft's, like, they've already been, like, releasing PC games. Like, most of the Xbox One games, they would release on PC anyway. So... It gave me no incentive to buy an Xbox One. So, if anything, this is actually a really good thing because I think it's more like the sign that they're not really like putting emphasis on, like I said before, they're not really putting emphasis on Xbox being like an exclusives console. They're putting an emphasis on like, you could buy this and play the games like this, or you could like just play it on your PC. I mean, it hurts. Yeah. It hurts the console market. I get that. It hurts their console sales. But at the end of the day, if people want to play a game, why should they buy like a $500 console to play it?
That's the thing. It's like the Switch is the least expensive out of the three.
Buy like and you know, you can be like me. Where, I mean, I have the exclusive Smash version, so...
The thing is with the Switch, though, is that it has more exclusivity, where...
Yeah.
Because it sold out immediately, and that does not show well for, like...
Do you know how...
how accessible it is to get a Switch.
Yeah. Do you know how thirsty people are over my Smash, like, my Smash dock? My like exclusive one.
Nice.
People fucking thirst over it. And it, good reason, it looks fucking hella sick, but you know.
Like, I don't know if it's on purpose, or not. Like, I don't know if it was just production wasn't that well planned for Nintendo, or that they did this to like make the Switch more valuable.
Get more demand.
Yeah. But no, like, speaking of, like, that exclusivity, like, the only, like, I haven't even played my PlayStation 4 ever. Like, my parents use it now, but, like, some of the exclusive games are, like, some I still want to play, like, Death Stranding, for example. I still want to play that.
Yeah. So me and Cube are excited.
Yeah.
So it gives me an incentive to actually buy the console. But at the same time, some people don't want to buy, like, expensive consoles to play one game.
It's kind of like the only games that I would ever play really for PS4 that I can just even name off the top of my head is Death Stranding, which luckily we have access to one that can be dedicated to streaming it. So, so Cube and I'm just going to, like, we're just going to split on the game and play it then, so we don't have to buy a full new
console. Links in the description to Volcanic Gaming.
Yeah, Volcanic.
Yeah.
Volcanic Incorporated, technically now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Volcanic Media Incorporated.
Volcanic Media Incorporated.
Yeah.
But yeah, and then the other one is Bloodborne, but like, I'm not going to lose.
Yeah. Yes, Bloodborne. Dude,
Bloodborne. But then again, now that's coming to the Switch.
But Bloodborne is coming to the Switch? It's
called Dark Souls, it could. Actually.
Whoa.
No, I'm saying Bloodborne, with Dark Souls being on the Switch now, it is entirely possible that Bloodborne can be on the Switch.
It's possible, but Sony has to prove it.
Yeah,
like, that's one of their actual like system sellers, so I don't know.
Yeah.
They seem to be holding the keys up to that. I don't know, I'm focused.
If they let Bloodborne, or if they open up the keys of Bloodborne, they lose every incentive for the PS3.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I don't know. I'm just happy Sekiro is coming out. So I'm just going to play that and be fine.
Anyways, final words on this?
I am excited because the thing is with the Master Chief collection is that did it sell well? When it first came out on...
Yeah,
I think it did, yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's the thing. Like, if it's going to be on Steam, what's going to be the difference, though? Well...
They're adding Reach and ODST. That's
the difference. Reach, I never got super into Reach.
Story, not great.
The story is
bad. But everything else was pretty good.
Multiplayer, popping. Firefight, pretty dang good.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited for it. So that's my last thought.
All right, so we should go to the next topic.
Yeah.
Why not?
Okay, so Crunchyroll has announced that they have partnered up with Toonami to put out exclusive anime to Toonami.
Yeah. And, like, okay, so this is really interesting knowing that, you know, Funimation just left Verve. So but the thing is, this is a TV deal.
Yeah.
So
like, yeah, it seems like a step backwards if anything.
Like no. It's that online is becoming more mainstream now, mainstream media. But like TV will always be the mainstream media to the TV execs' eyes, and also a lot of people that don't.
The old people, basically.
Yeah.
That are so technologically unadvanced.
Mm-hmm.
Who refuse to.
Yeah, they refuse to get like all these online subscriptions and all that. They just want to have a TV sort of thing. But yeah, having like all these is it just dubs though?
It's probably gonna be dubs.
I would assume so.
I'm excited because I still like anime dubs.
Hey, God forbid we advance our reading skills.
I'm still salty though with Toonami holding the rights to the dub for Kill la Kill.
What?
No, I'm saying like Toonami doesn't let like any other streaming service have the dub.
Not even DVDs. They don't.
Well, yeah, DVDs. I'm saying like a streaming service. Netflix doesn't have the Kill la Kill dub. Hulu, I don't think, has it.
To be fair, why do you need to watch the dub?
I mean, I like the dub.
It did pretty. It was okay. I admit it.
Well, that was great.
Most trigger dubs are pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I'm one of those people.
Watch the bloopers. Go watch the bloopers. It's hysterical.
Oh, yeah, the bloopers are great.
Oh, God.
Get off my dick, bitch.
Go ahead. But I'll give a meme.
I considering I paid upwards of $100 for the Kisniver DVD and heard the dub.
Oh, you. That was your mistake.
Yeah. I'm trying to support the official release, bruh.
Look, I just half the thing that sucks for me too is that I'm hoping that at least some of it gets added to Crunchyroll, because living in Canada, the limitations on trying to watch streamed anime is like kind of shitty.
Oh yeah,
I think I can get Funimation, which like maybe I do, but at the same time,
Toonami's not even in Canada, which is bullshit.
Yeah,
it's like Chorus Entertainment.
Well, okay, but the thing
is
that
works, but you can't own Toonami.
I did get a VPN, but like the fight back against VPNs on streaming services is so like fucking hard that I just don't want to bother, because it's
really?
Like the amount of effort. Yeah, no, the amount of effort I expend. So I pay for like a good VPN because I don't want to get a shitty one. Already, my internet is slow because I'm using the VPN now. And on top of that, I have to find the proper servers that haven't been taken down or blocked, because they're constantly upping and blocking it. And then if I find it, I have to join a server that's highly populated, so the streaming like quality is shit.
It's just not worth it. I stopped using VPNs because I go on this forum and I can't even use it when I have the VPN on.
This just means that Bridge Brains is never going to be sponsored by NordVPN.
Which I'm actually using right now, by the way.
I use NordVPN. It's decent. It's just, I don't... This is really
it's good, actually. It's never slowing me down, so...
It's nothing I need
to use.
I'm a
little
bit
to other sponsorships, but not Nord. Fuck you,
Nord.
Well,
thank you for that.
The possible NordVPN just went out the window.
They're like, I wanted that weeb money though.
We were about to fund you, but fuck that Nintels guy.
That Nintels guy really fucked over your deal with us.
I mean, at least God has to be happy in knowing that I have sponsorship. So,
hey, I heard that you shit on NordVPN. We are the competition. We would like to sign you a deal. Sign me up. Actually
you.
Really bad VPN made by
made by China.
I was gonna say China. India, but that would have been too culturally sensitive.
Yeah. But back to the actual topic.
What animes would you think would be on here? Like, what animes that have
I could definitely see Darling in the Franxx going over to Toonami.
I mean,
to be honest.
Yeah, obviously. Wait, is that owned by Funimation?
Maybe Adult Swim.
That's what we're talking about.
Hold on, let me see if Darling in the Franxx is owned by Funimation or not.
I'm pretty sure it's a Trigger show. So
yeah.
I don't know. I never watched it, nor do I care.
Trigger shows are on Crunchyroll.
In North America, it is owned by Funimation, but somehow in Britain and Australia, it is Crunchyroll.
That's weird.
That is weird.
That must be part of that partnership they had.
Yeah, that's weird for like a bunch of shows. It's like different countries, because Crunchyroll is mainly based in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
So like everywhere else, like their licenses are all screwy.
Yeah,
like so different from the U.S. Like I found out that Crunchyroll was actually a streaming Absolute Duo back when it first aired, but only in Japan.
What?
Yeah, it was
Toonami?
Really weird.
The only thing I ever use Crunchyroll for now is just borrowing my friend's account to watch JoJo.
I need to catch up on JoJo.
I need to watch JoJo.
Yeah.
Well, the first two seasons, or the first season is on Netflix for those who wish to.
Yeah, Netflix is getting JoJo. Fuck.
Nice.
which is super cool. And Netflix as a whole is getting it because it's on Canadian Netflix.
Yeah,
so.
maybe now I'll actually watch fucking JoJo, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty good. I've converted my entire server to JoJo now.
Because trash. Like,
hey, I just appreciate good stuff. Look, it's like I can't keep up with shows except very select things. Like, I read a lot of manga too, but like the only manga series I can actually keep up with is Berserk, and that's because a chapter comes out every 14 years.
Let's hope the fucking, 2016? 2017. Let's hope that never touches Toonami.
Maybe yeah. One day. If I could get. It's funny how it's like almost like a joke how one of the best drawn manga of like all time gets some of the worst anime adaptations. Like the original 1990, like the original Berserk anime is like not bad. It just stopped. So it's like, oh, well, neat.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's actually funny because Kimono Friends actually has better animation than Berserk.
Please
put Kimono Friends on Toonami. I don't even care.
I don't think that's going to happen.
I don't care if it's child-friendly or not. You have to do something with that property. Put it on fucking Toonami.
Not all the anime on Toonami is like
Kimono Friends is the most child-friendly thing ever.
Like,
I mean, it's that like or not, four kids. You have
I've
to
checked
think about
out,
that.
I've checked out the anime kids. They've been airing recently on Toonami. Not a lot of it is, not all of it is like adult and mature, and it's like lighthearted.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So it is entirely possible.
Yeah.
That Kimono Friends, but I don't see it happening. But.
I thought Adult Swim was like a section of Toonami. Where
no, Toonami's a section of Adult Swim.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's their anime. It's their midnight anime hour.
Basically. Oh, okay. Yeah, I got the mixed up.
Yeah. But yeah, this is a good progression, I think.
Yes.
But so, anyways.
Anyways, should we get to the next topic?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
Don't die, Chris.
I'm working on it.
So you know how everyone doesn't like the DCEU? How basically
yep.
it's
yep.
practically dead? Ben Affleck yep. says he's done. He's not playing
yep.
Batman
I don't,
anymore.
I don't blame him.
Yeah, on top of that, just to shit on it, James Gunn's back.
Yeah,
we'll get to that. Okay, we'll get to that.
I'm sorry.
We'll get to that.
I
yeah.
knew it was gonna come off.
Jump the gun.
But it's your fault that I didn't read
jump
the
gun.
Doc.
But yeah. Fucking, I don't blame Ben Affleck. To be honest,
yeah,
it's a Nigeria thing all over again.
The Batman franchise with DCEU is such a mess right now.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the one thing that I gotta say about Batman v Superman and Justice League is I actually kind of like Ben Affleck's version of Batman.
And the robotic
like,
voice
despite
that he
the
does.
Fact, like, sure. But, like, the one thing I did not like is how they wrote his character in the first movie. Like, he's a fucking killer psychopath. Like, I think that's what DC really has the heart on for these days.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But I was really... But I was really wanting to see a Ben Affleck just exclusive movie of him, like because the movie, the standalone movie they were planning on doing, was
going to
be
it.
Kind of like a spinoff. Yeah, but like it was going to be like some sort of spinoff of like Arkham Asylum kind of thing. Like it's going to be like them locked in the prison and
yeah,
going around with that. I remember there's like some tapes in that they showed in like Batman v Superman where it's like, yeah, this is the security camera of. The bat sighting, and it's like he drops from the ceiling really quick, picks up somebody. It's like, oh fuck, that just feels so much like Arkham Asylum.
Yeah.
Thinking that's what I would want.
But no, yeah. Like, in regards to the news about that Joker film, could this mean that we could be seeing like a complete reboot of the Batman series?
I don't. Yeah.
What Joker film?
I mean, think about it. Like,
the Joaquin Phoenix one?
Yeah.
The Whacking Phoenix.
So it's basically like a prequel of sorts to the whole Batman series. So maybe in a way, the new Batman that will be coming in would be like a direct sequel to the new Joaquin Phoenix Joker film.
Because, yeah, you know, they're... Because, you know, it's not like they had, like, a very long-running prequel series to Batman in any stretch going on. There, Gotham! Not having extended universes. Like, seriously. I actually want to look at the Warner Brothers exec who decided that and just, like, ask him, like, are you actually just challenged? I'm sorry. Like, how did you look at every... I don't know. Fuck. How did you think that was not a good idea to not have him in a connected universe? Like, sure, yeah, maybe I won't exactly see all the Marvel, like, TV actors in, like, a Marvel movie, but at least I know, like, they're relevant.
I mean...
Like, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
I mean, the
like,
original always... plan for DCEU was supposed to be the Christian Bale Batman was supposed to be in Batman v Superman. I mean, that was the reason why Man of Steel was called Man of Steel was because it was supposed to be a play on The Dark Knight.
But
The
only reason why it changed like afterwards was because Christopher Nolan walked out and Christian Bale walked out too. So they just rebooted the whole thing.
Yeah.
Actually, one thing that I would like to see if they go...
It kind of dooms the DCEU because the Nolan films were really good. And there was no way that Ben Affleck would have topped them.
Yeah. But here's one thing I would actually like to see from like the Joaquin Phoenix Joker like universe. If they decided to make it like a new universe, why couldn't they do like a Flashpoint universe where it's actually like Thomas Wayne as being Batman?
Because
like the Waynes would still be alive at this point because it's an earlier, like it's taking place in the 80s.
True.
Yeah.
That would be neat.
That would actually be an interesting way of like kind of keeping it in the same universe for as long as they can.
Honestly, just to anything to wash out the taste of Jared Leto's disappointment. To quote Movies with Mikey, a dumpster fire of human misery.
Okay, guys. Pop quiz. Who should play the next Batman?
Jack Black.
Optimus.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah.
I would say, in my opinion, Oscar Isaac. He plays that character in the Star Wars prequels. I think he would be the perfect choice for Batman.
That's in the prequels? Idea.
You know who I want?
Who?
Tommy Wiseau.
Yes. Well, hi, Joker. Oh, hi, Joker. How's your sex life?
Someone,
Batman!
I am Pigman!
Someone watching this, please make fan art of that. Dear God, I want to see that.
Yes. I want to see them popping out of the cowl.
People are watching this.
Oh, God.
It's amazing.
But yeah, fucking... Affleck walking out, not a big surprise. But it does set up that they could be doing a whole reboot series, which is weird because they just did a reboot series.
Yeah,
it's a reboot series on a reboot series on a reboot series on a reboot series on a reboot series.
I mean, to be fair, Spider-Man had 3 reboots in the span of 20
years. Yeah. But it's okay because Spider-Verse saved it.
Yeah, for real.
Homecoming was
not making fun of it.
Homecoming was great, and it actually is part of the MCU, other than the other one.
Yeah, I never really got into Homecoming, but I might watch it for the the upcoming Far From Home.
Yeah, no,
that looks badass.
Like Like, I don't like to compare it too much to Spider-Verse because they're, like, kind of separate movies and what they do.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, yeah, no. And also, to be honest, you got to have a little bit of nostalgia for, like, the Sam Raimi Spider-Mans. Like,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
A little bit.
Fuck you. Like, let's just pretend Amazing Spider-Man didn't happen and then we're all hunky-dory. Yeah. I don't consider those. Yeah.
I don't either. Like, yeah. They're terrible.
Anyways. You guys all good for the next topic?
Yeah.
Aladdin.
Yeah.
Aladdin. Oh,
no, I'm not ready for this.
Aladdin.
Okay. Okay. So let's talk about the first trailer first.
Okay, so where do we begin? Oh my God, Will Smith.
Okay. Okay, let's be fair. Let's be fair. The first trailer did not help.
Yeah.
The second trailer looked more decent.
Yeah.
And like, it looks not that, like, Genie doesn't look that bad in the rest of the film, given with the second trailer.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Like, it looks good for what it is. Like,
he slammed his head on the desk.
Yeah, me too.
But yeah, it's still memeable. Everything is. Oh, God. But it doesn't look bad for what it is. It's a live action that didn't need to happen. But it looks decent for what it is.
Can I just say that it's weird that I find Will Smith as the Blue Genie more Uncanny Valley than Alina Battle Angel is?
What?
We'll get into that topic, but
yeah.
God, Genie just doesn't look good in this. He just, oh God.
To be honest, CG though, I love Will Smith as a Genie more than I do fucking Jafar.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
That like, dude, that actor they got for Jafar is so bland.
Oh God,
I've not even
like,
seen him.
Will Smith, like when he's not in his like Genie form, he looks okay. He looks, you know, like Will Smith would look. It's just the CG body they superimpose onto Will Smith when he's like the Blue Genie is like. So uncanny, so like,
I mean,
weird and odd.
When he does the music number, it doesn't look that bad.
Oh yeah,
compared to when they first introduced him in like literally 5 seconds.
True.
Like I mean, yeah, he's not gonna top Robin Williams. Rest his
soul. Will.
But like,
yeah.
But like, it doesn't look bad as a lot of people are making it out to.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's still memeable, like I said, because it's, you know, a blue Will Smith.
Sorry. A blue Will Smith.
I mean, it is.
I'm sorry.
It's just, dude, imagine a fucking Smurf Will Smith.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
That
was what I was thinking.
It's Will Smurf!
Oh my God, if they do another fucking Smurf live action.
Will Smurf.
Will Smurf.
Just do exactly what they do here. Just just give like one of the Smurfs just Will Smith's face.
All of the Smurfs is Will Smith's face.
Fucking Thanos one. God for the head.
Oh God!
Gets hit with a hammer. Ah, oh, that's hot.
The
gun for the head, though.
Oh God.
Okay, but, so can we just talk about like some of the other casts outside of Will Smith? Princess Jasmine is being played by Naomi Scott, and honestly, she will be the highlight of the film because I saw her stuff in Power Rangers. Holy fuck, she has some chords. She could actually sing here. It's actually like impressive.
I mean, the scene, the whole new world didn't look that good, to be honest. It didn't sound that good to me. Like I said, live action, they're not going to top the original. That's fine.
Oh, yeah, obviously.
But, like, it still looks really off-putting.
But no, like,
it sounds off-putting.
I'm actually really happy that, like, she's going to be, a rising star in this movie. And it's, like, with that and the Charlie's Angels movie that she's going to be involved in, yeah, the future looks really bright for her. And I'm really happy.
Wait. Go back. Charlie's Angels is getting another movie?
Yeah, it's getting a movie. Christian
Stewart. What?
Christian Hollywood Stewart baby. Is playing one of the angels, as well as there was another person. Naomi Scott and Christian Stewart are in the movie. It's being directed by who's directing it?
I will say this, as weird as it is to have a 3D genie, I don't think they could ever pull off a Jafar's bird.
Yeah, Elizabeth Banks is handling the movie, and ironically, she was actually Rita Repulsa in that Power Rangers movie.
I mean, honestly, I don't know. Half the time, I just like it. Half of the Disney, like the new live action Disney movies, like I feel like none of them, like there's so many trailers stacking up on top of each other for none of them that have come out that I just like, I feel like the trailer just shows me the movie itself.
I don't need to
watch it. I think Aladdin is kind of more appealing than the others in the sense of like it's maybe it can make Aladdin be a little bit more not like extremely racially insensitive. Don't get me wrong, obviously Aladdin has a classic and I'm not going like, oh, you know, it's full-on racist, because I'm pretty sure it doesn't, Aladdin doesn't bug a whole lot of people.
No.
But at the same time, it's just kind of like, you know, it's you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it can do with a decent update, but like the other ones just,
I mean, the original, they actually replaced a whole line in the first song. Like, they were saying, like, it's barbaric, but, you know, it's home. They actually replaced a whole part of that.
Oh, yeah, like, talking about, like, pulling out a guy's toenails or whatever it was. Like,
oh, God.
Yeah.
You what?
It was like, I remember I was, like, in terrorism class. Like, you know, it's like,
they should teach you how to do that?
it's just basically learning about, it was like socials, but for like history of terrorism and stuff like that. It's kind of funny how they were talking about like the Hollywood, we were talking about like the Hollywood's depiction of, and just media's depiction of like Arab land, basically, where it's like, it's all
Arabia.
It's like this mixing of cultures, right, into one like Hollywood sand place where bad people are.
What?
Like that's basically what it is when you think about it. Like half the time they don't differentiate between all these different cultures in the Middle East.
Oh, I see.
Just kind of slap them together, yeah. So yeah. It's just this kind of going. Sorry, I'm going like way off topic, but Aladdin's probably gonna suck.
Yeah.
It looks more interesting than Dumbo, which Dumbo doesn't look too bad. It's just,
I mean, the original Dumbo didn't look that interesting, to be fair.
I mean, I'm just worried. I'm just like laughing because like they gave Tim Burton the rights to the movie that had pink elephants on parade.
Oh God!
If I'm gonna be able to watch that movie.
I think I might be incentivized to watch that movie now. I want to see what he does with those pink elephants.
Oh yeah,
I bet they'll be safe and they probably won't even do that scene. Which I hope Tim Burton gets a little bit more leeway.
If they
to do
don't
it.
Even bother to do the pink elephants on parade scene, what's even the point of doing the movie?
Yeah, that's
true. Yeah. Because
especially if you get Tim Burton to do it, thing. Like you don't expect Tim Burton to make something fucked up and weird.
Like, yeah,
God damn it, dude.
Tim Burton is a interesting draft.
The hoot and the holler.
But yeah, Aladdin looks more appealing than the other live action. So
yeah, that's not really you saying wanna... much, but you know.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Yeah. Anyways,
we'll be right back with some reviews on Captain Marvel, and we will
talk about James Gunn.
And we'll talk about James Gunn too.
Yeah, and then I'll die.
Right after these sponsors. Wait, we have sponsors? Holy shit, we have sponsors!
Hey there, bucko! Want a plushie that's not only cute, but makes you question your sexuality?
What?
Well, I got the toy for you! Introducing the Astolfo Plushie! The only plushie that tells you if you're gay or not! Using the latest developments in mechanical engineering and material science, the plushie will suck your Johnson and say you're gay. You're totally fucking gay.
Does it ever tell you if you're straight after it sucks it?
Why would it? It's sucking your dick.
For years, whenever I post something on the internet, people called me gay. Now I know I am gay.
10 out of 10 would end a 10-year marriage over it again.
Listen to me, Johnny. The Astolfo plushie is real, and it tried to suck my dick.
The Astolfo plushie. Selling now for only $50. Get yours now. Brought to you by Mattel. Yep, we're selling this shit now.
Do you love Diabolic Lovers Abridged?
No, not really.
Do you like clothing?
Yeah, sure, why not?
Do you want to support the people who pour hours of their lives into making this content?
That sounds like a great idea!
Introducing the new Diabolic Lovers Abridged t-shirts!
Finally, a shirt that says what we're all thinking.
This one really brings out my eyes! We have one for all your favorite all your favorite characters!
I don't have to lick this one, it already has my face on it.
Yeah, these shirts shrink, so be sure to buy them in large sizes. Just saying. All featuring artwork by the world-renowned Homicidal Teddy Bear! I'm gonna buy all of them, so all of them will be mine.
Buy it!
And if you want to be more discreet about your love for Diabolic Lovers Abridged, we also have Beth t-shirts. So why are you just sitting there? Go to teespring.com right now and get yours today.
Mikado, did your bear just talk?
Watching, we.
That was like a 1 second break.
That was like a 1 second break. Totally not like 5 hours.
I left the country in that time.
Now Wildcard's gone. Rest his soul.
Oh yeah, he's gone. He couldn't wait that long, so he just said, fuck it.
He's like, Captain Marvel cuts out of the call. That's how much he didn't like it.
It's like my Doom Patrol review?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just like that.
Pretty much. You know what? I'll just sum up my opinion this way.
But, yeah. Now,
all right.
What is the next topic, Nintles?
Okay, so we are going to be talking about Ghostbusters and how it's getting a legit sequel or reboot. Or let's just ignore the 2016 movie, guys. It's for real. This is Ghostbusters 3, right here.
The real Ghostbusters 3.
Well, there was the video game, that's like Ghostbusters.
That doesn't count, it's a video game! God damn it! You think people count Goonies 2 on the NES as the actual sequel?
Yes, I would.
It has 2 in the title.
So that means it must be.
I mean, if video game lore can count as actual, like, cinematic lore, that'd be great.
What world would that be? But yeah, like,
be a better world.
The Ghostbusters 2016 movie, yeah, it was a movie that didn't need to exist, honestly. This was one movie that, like, was doomed to fail from the start. Even disregard the female cast, the fact that they decided to reboot the film completely, like, not without the original cast, and not even with, like, a good director, and not even paying respect to the original, and moreover, more putting emphasis on the marketing as opposed to making a good movie, it was doomed to fail. In this case,
mean, that's why I think most movies nowadays just do. They pay more for, like, marketing than they do the actual fucking movie quality.
Yeah, but what's different about this time? Well, the son of the father who made the original franchise is directing this brand new movie.
Hmm.
So, hold on, let me look at his name.
Who is this guy and what has he done?
Yeah, what has he done?
It's Jason Redman. Jason Redman is the son of Ivan Redman. He directed movies like Juno. And also, he also did Up in the Air, another movie.
I've never heard of that one, actually.
Yeah, I haven't heard about that one either. But what makes it unique is because he's actually, like, a comedy writer and is actually well experienced in the whole, like, industry, especially since he's the father, he's the son of a great director like Ivan Reitman. So if anything, they're putting more emphasis that this will be a film for the fans, and this is a good thing.
It's fan service rather than trying to make a push an agenda.
It's fan service as opposed to feminist service. That's basically what it is. Okay.
Yeah.
Let me just put this out there. The 2016 movie wasn't bad because it had female Ghostbusters. That was not the reason why people didn't like that movie. The reason why was mainly because the cast they hired were unfunny, unrememberable. Most of them, like, one of them was mainly a two of them were actually stereotypes. We had the obligatory fat woman and the sassy black woman.
Well, Melissa McCarthy's funny. She was in it, right?
Yeah.
I found her way more annoying than funny in that movie. One of the only characters...
It seems like Melissa McCarthy only plays one character in all the movies. And, like, sure, some of them are a hit, but some of them are like, yeah, I've seen this before.
I think the only, like, highlight of the film was really, like, that one sassy girl that was, like... She was basically, like, the flirty type. She had the crazy hair and stuff. But even then, she didn't really have that much lines. But no, like...
Yeah, I don't remember a lot from the movie.
All I remember is that there was literally the Ghostbusters logo was literally the villain of the movie. I'm not joking. The villain of the movie was literally the Ghostbusters logo. And you don't want to know how they defeated that fucking ghost? They shot
crossing
him in the dick.
Beams.
They shot him in the dick.
Do ghosts have dicks?
So bad.
He's got a ghost penis.
See, I'm just more of the opinion where, I mean, I'll just flat out say it. Like, if it's not, like, if it doesn't involve Harold Ramis, then I'm just, like, interested. Like, seriously. Like, even a new one, new Ghostbusters, I don't care.
Yeah.
It's not going to be interesting me at all. Like, I don't care if it's for the fans. It's just like, it's not going to be the movie that people are looking for, even if it does like kind of tickle their fanboy glands. Yeah, it's just not going
to
be.
It's going to be impossible to do the film without Harold Ramis. But no, like my opinion is it's doable to do a Ghostbusters film with a female. Look at Extreme Ghostbusters. That TV series had a female on the team. The problem with what Ghostbusters, the 2016 movie did, was that it ignored, it basically was like a full-on reboot, and it ignored the legacy that was put up by the original directors. And not only that, when people actually voiced their opinions of it, this is not really going into the film itself, they labeled it, like, people who were complaining about the film as sexist, when clearly it shouldn't have been because of sexism, it was because you made a bad movie.
Well, I mean, that's just it. It's kind of like, you know, the reason that most of them don't really get Ghostbusters right is because it's like they try to write the new ones like comedies, and it's like, if you look at the old Ghostbusters, like the subtlety, like you, like I've had people who didn't even really think that Ghostbusters was a comedy on the grand scheme of things.
Yeah.
Like that movie has subtlety. That movie does not present itself as a comedy. Like I will be honest, if you go back and kind of watch it, like it has that kind of mood about it where everybody is a little bit more serious than you would think, yet the comedy isn't what happens around them.
Yeah.
So, like, even the, yeah. But
I have
like,
to put you guys on hold for a second. I got a call.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, I wonder. At least he tells people when he leaves. I'm not gonna lie. I just kind of.
Hello.
For a second. I assume no. Did anybody notice?
What?
Oh, there you go. Sure. Nobody did.
Sorry. Just give me a second.
Okay.
All right. So,
back to what I was saying.
Yeah. No, back to what fucking Hunter was saying.
Oh, no, I just said like I got up and left for like a couple seconds because my phone was ready just now, even though I hoped it was ready on my break.
No,
but I don't think anybody noticed.
No, so, like what were you saying about this?
Ghostbusters?
Yeah.
Oh, I honestly don't care much. half of the time, there's so much negative shit around Ghostbusters from people. It's kind of why I don't like keep up with people who claim to be like Star Wars fans. I don't know. It just turns into such a shit spewing.
With the complaints about Star Wars, like. Mostly, people are not happy. Like, they're never happy with whatever happens with Star Wars. People complained about the prequels, and now they're complaining about the sequels. It doesn't matter if the movies are legitimately, like, awful or not. The fact that people are not happy about that, like, it renders their opinions pointless, in my opinion.
There's not a Star Wars video. There's not a Star Wars movie that I don't have feelings for. I like them all. I'm just that kind of guy. Cue the overseer's video there of Star Wars fan. Wow! I love that so much.
Look, new Star Wars content.
Wow!
It's
new Star Wars.
Wow!
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 That speaks to me so closely.
It's just more of a matter of like treating the fans with respect and not catering to propaganda or anything like that. Well, mostly just creating a good product. That's the first thing that is important. So who I would cast what I would want for this sequel or this new movie. Have the old cast come back in some way, shape, or form. Maybe even in, like, an academy for them. Have some brand new blood for the characters that are not stereotypes. and just create a good movie. I wouldn't mind if they have like a female in the movie. I wouldn't mind that. I would want it so everyone could get a shot. It's both men and female, not just female only.
Yeah,
that's my thoughts on it. I would love to see RC Tyler. Fuck, what was his name?
Put Idris Elba in it. There you go.
RC.
Yeah.
He can just be in everything and I'm okay.
That guy from Power Rangers. The
oh my god.
Billy from Power
Rangers.
Oh boy.
I know. Bringing it up, but we've never Rangers. Seen it.
RJ yeah, that guy Siler. About,
I don't know. The guy, for a female, it comes to my mind that I like, I've only seen in a few things, and namely just one movie is Ruby Rose from like her part in John Wick.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
I want to see more of her. She was a good actress.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. But, like,
yeah.
I want an opportunity to tell new stories, not just retelling the old story, but gender bending them. I don't want that. I want brand new blood in the franchise, but that's also what, paying respect.
That's what the.
Like,
that's what the 2016 version really was. It was just a, you know, Ghostbusters, this really good franchise. What if we gender bent it?
Yeah, that's exactly.
Create
what
a lot of fan fiction.
Yeah, just do what Star Wars did with The Force Awakens. Just have the old cast interact with brand new characters, and just have pass the torch. Do that, and yeah. People yeah. won't have a problem with it.
Yeah.
In fact, people
well,
will love
oh,
it.
People will still have a problem with it because, you know, Star Wars did that, and people always had a problem with Star Wars films.
Oh, yeah, obviously.
But yeah, if
you're
they...
You're just copying Star Wars.
But, I mean, yeah, if they have, like, the old cast, like, be, like, mentors, then, yeah, I could be behind that if they really want to make this new cast, you know, likable.
Yeah. I mean, as long as they don't harass, like, as long as fans don't harass, like, cast members, then I think we'll be good. Honest yeah. to God.
As long as they act like human beings, I'm yes. sure they'll be good. Which is kind yeah. of hard for most, apparently, like, nerd fandoms nowadays.
Yeah.
Like, oh, well, here, let me explain why it's okay for me to go and harass this person. All right.
Anyways, so yeah. Should we get to the next topic?
Yes, please.
All right, next topic. So there is a brand new trailer for Avengers Endgame, and still no Thanos. Just right off the bat.
Yeah.
Oh, Avengers I mean, we dead. Saw Thanos in a previous trailer. We saw his head.
He's there. You just can't see the rest of them.
This is just a new villain. Yeah, Thanos is just he's off. He's on vacation. Endgame is him trying to figure out a villain, you know, without everybody being alive.
Yeah, it's just the Avengers just doing shit until the time passes.
Yeah. Okay, which trailer are we talking about? Because there was a recent one that just came out. So
yeah, we're talking about the recent one.
Yeah.
The one where they, like, donned white suits and just start walking to some
they just
random
start
place.
Walking.
I will point out, I don't think Poptimus has seen it yet. And I have advised him. And I have advised him, too, that there are some spoilers in it. So, not to watch it.
You know what? Just talk about it. I don't care.
I mean, yeah. It's not too much spoilers outside.
Yeah, it's a trailer.
Yeah, I mean, I think they spoiled one big thing, really, like, later on in the thing.
Captain Marvel?
No.
Oh, shit, Captain Marvel's in the movie?
Shit, what the fuck?
But, apparently, like, no, they...
Well, here, I'll put the spoiler out now, so pop if you want to cover your ears if you don't want spoilers.
Oh, just say it. Like, whatever.
Okay, well, the fact that Tony Stark is walking amongst them in the white suits.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
So he survives the...
He comes back early on in the movie, yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
So that whole thing of him maybe being in space for most of the movie does not happen. He lands on Earth.
Oh, yeah,
some
that's
point
right. You were saying that he was going to die in our space.
He's not going to die in space.
Well, I knew he wasn't going to die, but like honestly. I thought they would have this whole struggle with him getting back to Earth, not just immediately go back to Earth. Like,
and they've only mentioned that everything they're showing in trailers is only coming from the first, I think, half hour of the movie.
Jeez. Oh my god, that's...
Only the first half
that
hour?
That's awful.
Only the first half hour.
That sounds awful for a trailer.
Marvel. Stop cock-teasing us! Show us more!
Yep. There's so much they're not showing us.
Dude.
They're deliberately doing that. It's fucking beautiful.
But dude, that means... But dude, that means that first half hour is just so rushed. That makes me worried, actually.
Curious how they're gonna do it.
Hmm. Yeah.
Well, I don't know.
I hear it's actually gonna be
like
I think it might actually be the longest.
Like keeping quiet deliberately, I think holy fuck, they're really going all out with how. Like, if this actually does really well, how this marketing campaign does, it could probably change the whole game of how marketing of movies is done.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Preferably not, you know, spoiling a movie. Like,
yeah.
The first, like bit of a sitting down into the theater.
Oh, fuck. What happened with Spider-Verse there?
Yeah. So I go into Spider-Verse and I'm just thinking, like, I didn't know much about it. I was wanting to be surprised because everybody was thinking, this movie's great. Go in and then Mr. Smarmy guy comes up here. All right, so Spider-Verse takes into a universe where the original Peter Parker has died and Miles Morales needs to figure out how to be Spider-Man. However, the dimensions are coming together, names all the different spider people, as they need to team up to defeat Kingpin. I'm just like, this is the first 40 fucking minutes. It's like, oh my god.
So wait, a guy like in the movie was actually spoiling the movie for you?
Yeah, well,
no, like they
like,
have like
wow.
That's
yeah, they have like
such...
the pre-show that they do.
That's such terrible. A douchey thing to do.
And like he'd never seen any of the trailers, so he had no idea that it had all these other spider
he did it with Captain Marvel too, which pissed me off.
Yeah.
It reminded me of like we have this Canadian movie like thing called Cineplex, a movie feeder, and there's like this like pre-trailer thing is like don't be a spoily Sandy or something.
Yeah, oh yes. Don't be a Susie seat kicker.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you like the...
Don't
the,
be a
the,
Harvey Hogger or whatever.
Yeah.
Do you like the Colonel saga? Oh, yeah.
Colonel here.
You fucking
God, Adam
Canadians.
Sitting there with a grin on his face being like, I love these. I'm like, fuck.
Oh
I hate
my
you
God.
So much, Adam.
Because he knows that he's one of them. He's like, oh, that's me. I'm getting representation here.
Oh, my God.
Finally. Some representation.
Okay.
Okie doke.
You fucking Canadians.
you fucking Canadians.
But yeah, like,
anyway,
it scares me that they're doing it like that, but it also intrigues me.
Yeah,
I'm just hoping they don't screw it up in some way.
It's super weird. If that's just like the first half hour, like Tony Stark comes back from the space station, and they have like these people in white suits. It's like. What is there else?
Well, to
like,
think about it,
you can really
get a lot done in a half hour.
Yeah,
true. I mean, it is superhero logic. So,
Yeah, I don't think there's really any reason to be too worried.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be a good movie.
It just makes me... The only reason it makes me worried is because, you know, if they're rushing things like that, like Captain Marvel, I'll get back. I'll explain later about that.
I'll explain that too.
Yeah, it was rough. Anyways,
I'll explain my side too.
The movie doesn't look too bad. So far.
Yeah.
And it just makes me wonder who else survived the snap. And they're gonna reverse it somehow.
And there's also a rumor going around that there is a motivation why Thanos actually was capturing all the stones. I'm not gonna go into full detail on it, but I'm hoping what they're like revealing will be the case, because it could lead into the fourth phase of the MCU in like a very interesting fashion.
Yeah, I mean, if you pay attention to Infinity War and the comics, his reasoning isn't that bad. It's just how he doesn't how Thanos doesn't take into consideration how just by getting rid of resources or by getting rid of people doesn't get rid of the need for resources. Like his whole reasoning with taking out half of humanity or half of life was to have more resources. But by getting rid of half of life, that means more the resources that you have are going to be in more demand. It's not going to fix things.
Yeah, but anyways, final thoughts on the trailer?
Looks good.
Seems like it sounds pretty decent, all right.
Yeah, Poptimus, go see it later.
Some point.
Speaking of the MCU, James Gunn is officially coming back for Guardians of the Galaxy 3.
And more stuff for Marvel, probably.
Hopefully.
We win.
And also still directing Suicide Squad.
So, yeah. That's the huge thing I see out of this. Like, I think they would have rehired him eventually.
Yeah.
But like, the big thing to take out of James Gunn going back to Marvel now is that he's working for both Marvel and DC.
Yeah,
which means Disney and Marvel are being so compliant with him basically building bridges between these two mega companies, these two mega fandoms, to come together to just coexist, basically.
Yeah, hopefully that's the case.
And that's amazing to me. To see James Gunn basically build bridges.
Oh yeah, it just it's weird considering the fact that the reason that he got fired was because of some badly written, badly joked tweets
that he apologized during that time. Anyways,
yeah,
like
here's the thing:
people just like to try to ruin someone's career.
Yeah. Here's the thing, what he tweeted, like, there were like 100 tweets, mostly about children, about like edgy jokes about children and stuff. I can understand why people are angry about that. I totally get it. Pedophilia is not okay in any circumstance, but where do we draw the line on jokes? Like, what is not funny? What is funny? If we are going to be censoring people based off of certain joke and like fire them, shouldn't like no one's going to be working, because that's basically the death of comedy. It, like it is similar to Roseanne and how she got fired. She made a joke about like like some Republican, and yeah, it was a pretty bad joke because she didn't know that she basically called her an ape, even though she didn't realize that she was black. She got fired because of that. The problem is, like, I'm a free speech absolutist, and I agree that both Roseanne and James Gunn shouldn't have been fired. I do not agree with their, like, what they did, but they're still people. They still have jobs to do. So,
and again,
you can't just end their life because of it.
Exactly.
And again, he did apologize during that time. And when he got fired, these tweets were old, like,
yeah,
really old.
Yeah, like 10 years old.
Yeah, so like he apologized during those time when he made those tweets.
Yeah.
And then someone just took those old tweets, put them out of context, and not including the apologies, and just ruined this man's career.
Well not actually
now it's bettered his career.
Yeah, it actually did.
Like Zay Overseer, former member, mentioned this to us, that if he had not been fired, none of this building bridges between MCU and DCU would happen.
Yeah.
None of that would happen without what James Gunn did or what the person did to him. It's a whole weird turn of events.
Yeah. There's actually people saying that Disney actually didn't fire him, and actually, like, they basically just, like, faked it so they could get that, so they could avoid bad publicity, which...
They just wanted to create clout.
And Fox.
Yeah.
But
I don't know.
I don't know about that Fury, but...
I think that's baloney.
Yeah.
Baloney.
Yeah. But no, like James Gunn, he did fantastic with the first two Guardians of the Galaxy movies. Especially Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Honestly, like the most underrated MCU movie in my opinion. Like, it's a fucking masterpiece, that movie. Like people need to go see that movie. It's fucking fantastic.
I like that they're naming these sequels like by volume.
Oh yeah, that's even better.
It's interesting.
But the fact that he left, that he got fired, it really set like a bad sentiment for me on where the MCU would go. It basically put my mind, after Endgame, it's over. But now, with James Gunn back, I'm hoping that nothing else ruins the franchise, because, like, he was the saving grace of what made, like, he'll be the saving grace of what makes Phase 4, like, still good.
Yeah.
In my opinion, like, his movies were, like, the best movies in the MCU, and... I'm just hoping to God, Nate. Like,
let's be honest. Who here, even really cared about the Guardians of the Galaxy before he touched them and made movies about them?
Not really.
I never even heard of them.
Exactly. They're like, I didn't either at first. I looked into them after like a trailer for the first movie. I find it so cool that Disney is not even gonna stop him from doing Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
And that they're not gonna make him do it at the same time as Guardians. They're gonna let him do Suicide Squad before he goes and does Guardians. They're like, yeah, we're just gonna let you do that before you do this.
Which is good.
Like, take your time. Like, That's such progressive coming from Disney.
Yeah, totally. And not only that, but like, some years before this, it was illegal to work for their separate company because the contract breaching.
Yeah, the whole contract thing. After he left, people were worried, like, would he be able to go to DC because he still had some kind of contract thing. And at the time when he was working on Guardians, he had thought about like working on DC properties, but he couldn't.
Yeah,
like Disney is like as weird as it is for them to own Marvel, this is a very progressive step for both Disney and Marvel. Like, that's saying something for Disney.
But no, like,
anyways,
this news is really good because, like, it basically is saving the MCU from possible destruction. This is going to the next topic. Possibly because of Captain Marvel. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm just gonna like dip my finger into the piranhas. I thought it was good.
Just a lot of wasted names that don't mean diddly shit. This is bullshit.
Who gives a shit? Alright. So...
Okay, we're gonna review this before we actually talk about the news and controversy surrounding this film. We're gonna actually review the movie.
Yes.
So,
I'll just let you talk about it because I have a lot to say.
Yeah. So, well, everyone's gonna have their own say. My say on it is that, like, it wasn't bad. Like, the first 20 minutes, like 20 so minutes, were very rushed. Like,
I can agree. Yeah. a little uninteresting, a little confusing.
Yeah, it was. I was so confused. Like, if I went into this film knowing nothing about Captain Marvel.
But I also
or even like Marvel movies in general, I would be so fucking confused about this.
Oh yeah,
I think that's I think to its credit, I think that can be one of its advantages, is it kind of like mixes up the pace in a way of like what you, it's like, oh man, you know, you have another like, oh, the hero discovers their hero and gets the and goes on the hero journey, you know, like that in the movie form is a little bit like overplayed. Like, we've said and done it, right? It's like how they had to mix things up for Homecoming with Spider-Man. So like, I feel like I can appreciate the beginning parts of it once I finally watch the movie as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
But I can feel where it's like a little slow.
And my next point, by the way, we should have said we're gonna say spoilers. But my next point is that
Thanos dies.
but the thing about her, you know, being part of this, what was it, the Creed race or whatever?
Yeah, the Creed.
The Kree. I thought it was like Creed. But,
how could you think that? That's
why? That's just stupid.
That's really dumb.
But the thing about her being part of this Kree race, they never, and then the guy turning on her in the end, that it, I didn't feel anything for that because they rushed everything at the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, I had no connection with, oh no, this person that's known her most of her life did this to her. Like, I didn't have any connection with her being turned on by this race that she was attached to. by this alien race that she was attached to.
Yeah.
Because they rushed everything at the beginning that I'm like, okay, cool, she has a new enemy. Like, yeah, that was a big complaint I had with it. It's that I had no attachment with that whole thing happening.
Okay.
Another thing with how she got her name, Captain Marvel, was that she got it from a pilot how they pronounced it was Marvel. And that was just really interesting, but also really weird.
Yeah.
And like, and they didn't even really touch upon it till like the very end. Speaking of the very end, and names, the way they try to come up with like how the Avengers name came to be.
Yeah.
Carol Avenger Danvers.
Yeah, it didn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. And also, it's not I don't think it's canon.
Okay, so
at all.
Here's my thing about this. So people are saying that Captain Marvel retconned the MCU. Well, here's the thing. They're basing this off of the Captain America, the first Captain America movie's title, Captain America, the First Avenger. In that movie, didn't actually say he was the first Avenger, or they established the Avengers.
It wasn't actually name dropped that he was an Avenger.
Yeah, it wasn't name dropped.
Exactly.
But so that complaint is like completely bogus, in my opinion. What isn't, however, is the whole thing with the Tesseract. There's a bit of a plot hole where basically in that movie the Tesseract goes into the bottom of the ocean. But then somehow it ends up, I think, in outer space or something.
Yeah, it ends up with the Kree.
Yeah, for some reason.
It's probably an explanation.
I'm hoping there's an explanation, but like, it just leads to like utter like confusion, in my opinion.
Yeah, and then at the end, it gets eaten up by the fucking cat. Which what were they referring to its race as, like the alien race?
Yeah, that, like a blargle something.
Yeah, which I think is like, isn't that the cat race for the that one cat character that's in the Green Lantern franchise?
Not sure.
Because there is a cat. There is a cat lantern. I forget. I think it's like red lanterns or yellow lanterns. I may be mistaken, but there is a cat character like that, and I'm wondering if that's the race that they're talking about.
Yeah,
but anyway,
well, that just would make sense to make an Easter egg for a DC title.
Yeah
how Nick Fury got his eye,
that would be cool though.
How Nick Fury got his eye patch was also really dumb.
Yeah, I found it kind of funny, but like, it is kind of weird at the same time.
They basically just Ryan Johnston it, in my opinion. They just pulled a Luke Skywalker just throwing the lightsaber into the ocean with that.
Just,
I don't think it was that bad.
How did you get that? The eye patch. Shut up. None of your business.
Okay. So here's my complaints about the movie. So first and foremost, the movie is boring. It's really fucking boring. Nothing happens until the majority of the movie, like until like the end of the movie. Like most of the film is like Captain Marvel just going around, just like driving and stuff. She meets Nick Fury. Some guy said, smile more to her. That legitimately pissed me off.
I will say that Nick Fury, though, this is the most involved he's been in a Marvel film.
Yeah.
Like this is the most involvement he's ever had in a Marvel film. And that's funny to me. And also how old he is at the time period of this movie.
Yeah.
Which what apparently about, the...
What about Winter Soldier?
The effects they did
I know he fucking dies, but
they
like
did on Samuel Jackson, yeah, they were a bit inconsistent in my opinion.
Yeah.
But most of it I didn't really notice until like I
was confused about the time period of the film, by the way, like at first.
Yeah.
Then did I the Blockbuster thing not
I started connecting the dots. Blockbuster, fucking pagers, and then they dropped they name dropped Fresh Prince. So I'm like, takes place in 1995.
And there's also a scene where Captain Marvel is like using a keyboard. She's like pointing her fingers to the direct keys, and then you hear the Windows 95 sound. I thought that part was actually really funny.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think my problem with the film comes down mainly to Carol Danvers or Brie Larson in the film. Okay, so there's either in this film she's either emotionless, like she's showing barely any emotion, or she's like really smug and she's having that look.
That's the thing I really took away from her, is that she was so smug. Yes. In every dialogue she had.
Yeah. Here's the thing about Brie Larson. She does a great job with the MCU, like, humor. You know, that MCU still has that humor that is, like, very sarcastic and blunt. They've had that since, like, I think Iron Man 2. In which Iron Man 2, it was insufferable when they did that. But they owned that craft ever since Avengers. But she still has that type of like tone to her that like fits well with the MCU. The problem is she's not a good hero, in my opinion. Or more, they just wrote her as a bad hero. She acts like a Power Ranger in this film. I'm not joking. They wrote her like she's like a one-dimensional Power Ranger. And in the series that's supposed to be more dramatic base and more story driven, when you're having a character that is like gets all these powers and is like perceived as so perfect and stuff, it really does feel out of place.
That's the thing I've said about Captain Marvel, is that she's basically the Marvel version of Superman.
Yeah, exactly.
Which Superman is fucking broken. Yeah.
Nobody likes Captain Superman Marvel, because he is one-dimensional.
He's bland. Like,
but here's the thing about Superman. This is getting to my next point. He has a weakness. He gets hurt by kryptonite and stuff. What was the weakness in this movie for Captain Marvel? What, she lost her memory? That she didn't remember who she was?
Realistically,
by that logic too, what's Thor's weakness?
Yeah.
Like, he literally had to be beaten by Death's incarnate by destroying his hammer. That's not really much of a weakness.
Yeah.
I feel like Captain Marvel's kind of one of those characters where her weakness is just, like, obviously she has her limits. She's not, like, limitless. She'll probably get, like, it's similar in the way of Thor, right?
Yeah, but like, it kind of like exposes a problem with Marvel in general, where the thing with Marvel is most of these characters are human. They don't really have that much weaknesses outside of their humanity. With a character like Captain Marvel, though, literally having the power of the Tesseract and basically being extremely overpowered and can destroy like fleets of ships in one single punch.
I mean, again, Thor.
Yeah.
She's the one punch woman.
Like, yeah. I don't know. When it comes down to, like, powering, I think that, like, she never really bugs me because, sure, she's been, like, she's the most powerful, like, Marvel hero that's come out up till now for the most part. But, like, that kind of really makes sense considering, too, that she's, like, the last one really they're revealing.
Yeah.
And on top of that, it's, like, we've had other heroes that have that ridiculous amount of power, like, especially being Thor. I mean, fucking Thor, you know, actually won against Thanos.
I mean, he's a demigod.
Yeah.
Like, you can't go more powerful than a fucking god.
But, like, the Tesseract is a fragment of the, you know, like, the Tesseract is an Infinity Gem that's the Infinity Gems almost transcend gods, in a sense.
Yeah.
Like their logic to the universe. So, like, I don't know. It's just a matter of, I don't really think that she comes off as, like, too powerful or anything from what we've seen. I just, yeah, I think it's overall, like, it's fine. Like, I don't really think we need to see Superman like, a whole lot of weakness. Because that's one thing Marvel's done well, is that a lot of weaknesses have been kind of, like, abstract. I mean, you know, you look at something like Black Panther, like his weakness in that movie was his pride when he lost the fight for rule, you know, being the king.
Yeah.
Chris, what are you doing?
Sorry, I was just trying to get over night again.
You're trying to what?
Sorry, I just had to go peep my guts out.
Oh.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear about that.
Oh, it's so fucking cold. Anyways. Okay, let's keep going. What are we at?
Okay, so where was I? Okay, so I don't know if this will go into the next like part. Like, should we go into the controversy?
No. I do want to say that.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with Optimus that like her being overpowered, it's not really too big of a deal. Like her being superpowered, not that big of a deal. Considering one, like I said, she's the Marvel version of Superman. If they want to establish her as such, fine. My problem with her is the way she comes off as being super powerful.
Yeah.
Like, her smug attitude is what bugs me with her being that powerful.
Have we watched the first Thor movie?
Oh, actually, I walked out of that movie.
I'm the god of Asgard. I'm a god. Look at me go. Literally, the entire movie is Thor getting over smugness.
I mean, yeah.
Yeah, but that also wasn't the best reviewed Thor movie either.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's not caused the greatest uproar that it would ruin the entire cinematic universe.
No.
So, like, fair, I mean, I think her smugness... It was a phase one film, too. So, like, this film feels a lot like a phase one film, which is not a good thing considering we had films like Thor Ragnarok, which had, like, fucking... It had fucking... that one character... fuck, what was his name?
Yeah.
It was Jeff Goldblum.
Jeff Goldblum?
Yes.
Jeff Goldblum?
Oh, what are you going to do now, Mr. Goldblum?
It had Jeff Goldblum, and, like, it was fun. Like, this movie felt like it was unfun. It was boring.
Oh, dude, I was laughing my ass off just being able to see Nick Fury.
Like, yeah.
I remember me and Chris lost our shit with Coulson just being left there. Like, I love Coulson. I watched four or five seasons of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So like that was like that was a great little moment.
I actually loved that part.
I think it was great being able to see kind of the young Nick Fury come into who he was.
Like
that was actually cool.
This bored with an MCU film since The Incredible Hulk. It's that boring. Yeah. You remember the Incredible Hulk with how
Thor Dark
that
World
was?
Is like 400 times more boring than this. Name one redeeming quality of Dark World.
Natalie Portman.
How is that a redeeming quality?
She's cute.
What?
She's cute. That's what? About it.
Yeah, so, like...
That's unfortunately the only bit.
That's really not much of a quality, of a redeeming quality.
I know. That's what makes it sad.
Yeah. So, like, I don't know, man. I don't know how... I don't know if it's the most, like, boring Marvel movie. Just like...
Mm. Yeah. Hmm. But I did like all of Nick Fury's parts, though.
Yeah, Nick Fury is great.
My favorite part, though, during the whole rushed 20 minutes part was this line: "Am I the only one that's confused here?"
Really?
I said in the theater. I don't know if people heard me, but like when they said that line, I'm like, "No." I was very confused in the first 20 minutes.
And there was also a line that was like, "You know, it's called a cockpit for a reason."
Just the Kree lines were so Just the Krees in general, and Captain Marvel, or Carol, as she comes out to be
Carol.
Carol, they're just smug assholes. But yeah, so let's talk about the controversy of this film.
Ooh, here we go. Okay, so the whole controversy started with Brie Larson talking about white people critics. Now, this is something that it's not a big deal for me. Like, any type of media pundit will be talking about this stuff. The thing that matters was the fact that this led to mass dislikes of the want to see section on Rotten Tomatoes. So it doesn't matter if they're like a reactionary type, like a bunch of social justice warriors were angry that she dared insult white people. It doesn't matter about that. What matters was the fact that Rotten Tomatoes outright removed the feature because of this. Because people were angry. So, like, this is the thing about, like, censorship. When you censor people, it's going to lead to backlash. It's going to lead to dissenting opinion. It's going to lead to anger. And this led to a campaign to, like, basically, like...
Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering.
Yeah, exactly. So the people that were not interested in seeing the movie in the first hand, they had more of a reason to be angry about the film. So when that movie actually came out, people were actually starting to bomb the reviews again with the audience score. And Rotten Tomatoes caved in again and started, like, altering it again. So people cannot say bad things about the film. It doesn't matter if they're, like, trolling or not. If someone actually has a problem with the film, they cannot voice their opinion. And this is not only... It doesn't just affect the reviews. Rotten Tomatoes is owned by Fandango. You know what they were trying to do? They... like, refused people to cancel their pre-orders to see Captain Marvel.
What?
Yeah,
what?
They were actually, like, outright refusing people to cancel their pre-orders.
That's actually illegal.
Yeah.
That's not okay.
Well, I mean, depending on the type of... There's probably, when you signed up for it, there was a little clause that if we wish, we can refuse any pre-orders.
Yeah, the fine print.
Yeah, no, yeah, the one nobody reads. It's like my favorite one is Steam, how they can just actually take away games.
Your entire Steam library.
Yeah, you don't. In fact, I actually found out, if you die, you actually do not, you're not legally entitled to give it to anybody.
Really?
What?
Yeah, no.
What?
If you you're not legally entitled. I did a lot of searching. If you are to die, then you are not legally entitled to give your account to somebody else.
Wow.
What the fuck?
That's crazy.
That is bullshit.
Yeah. I'm surprised nobody knew this.
Wow. That's horseshit. Like,
yep, no. So you can't really like bequeath your... Not like they would enforce it. It's in the same vein as like they're not going to enforce mass removing of like your games on one person. It's just like a clause that's there. But yeah, no. Yeah, no. You're not legally allowed to do that.
That's ridiculous.
It's the same as selling your Steam profile, right? It's just like,
wow.
Yeah.
Not allowed to do that.
I mean, yeah. I could see that, but like,
but no. I don't know when it, and when it comes to like the review bombing and censoring the marks at one point. Yeah, sure. I can see why it's very much frustrating and it feels like just complete censorship for them to remove these user scores. But
well, yeah,
at the same time when it, well, but when it's this like extremely negative campaign that is like this, I don't know, I feel like it's a bit
well skewed. Movies will get this campaign anyway, and this is the problem with our media. Like, we live in a society basically.
Yeah.
So this is the exact repeat of what they did with Ghostbusters. But honestly, Ghostbusters at least did try to censor people's opinions. Like, this time, they were outright altering reviews and, like, saying, oh, yeah, you're a sexist if you don't like this movie. That's not okay. Like, somebody, like, if someone actually has a gripe with a movie, they should have a right to say what they think.
I feel like it's the amount of, like, it's more in the sense that this is... like a mass campaign of bombing this review rather than like actual proper discourse. That's why I don't really feel too bad, because it's like it's not like there aren't Marvel movies out there that have like shining reviews. I mean, just look at like Thor and some of the earlier Marvel movies. Like, they don't have the best shining reviews. But, like, at the same time, they got those reviews over fair and, like, balanced, like, people went out, watched, gave their opinion. Whereas this, it's like, the movie has barely been out. Most people probably haven't even watched it and are just giving this mass, like, attack.
Yeah.
That, yeah. I feel is unfair. But, like, at the same, it's like, oh, you're skewing people's opinions. But it's like, are you not skewing people's opinions, too, if you include these thousands of people who are just doing it to shut the movie down? Like,
right.
That's also fairly unfair.
But at the same time, you're changing a whole section of the website to cater to, like, to censor somebody's opinion, regardless if they actually want to see the movie or not. They, like, you basically changed the whole format of your website so no one could actually voice their opinions. It affects everyone, and that's the problem.
I think this is gonna lead to how Rotten Tomatoes or Fandango really take approach to these sort of things, because this isn't the first time, like as Pokemon said, this isn't the first time a movie has like bombed and people just leave like bad reviews that they may be justified, they may be not.
Yeah.
The way they approach this movie in particular is not looking good for them.
Yeah.
I think this really reflects on how they need to look at these sort of things.
Mm-hmm. Like,
so like it's like YouTube, you know? YouTube has learned nothing.
Yes.
from Rewind.
Like, and also, like,
Rewind is the most disliked video on the entire site.
Yeah.
Oof,
yeah.
And they have learned nothing.
Mm-hmm.
That's not hot.
what was I gonna say? Well, it's more of like, fuck. You could go ahead because I forgot what I was gonna say.
Yeah, fuck. No, I'm done with that. It's just, I think Rotten Tomatoes. Yeah, they did an oopsie. But like, I think this will turn out for the better that they'll really consider how they look at these sort of bombings, how these sort of raids that they get of bad reviews.
I mean, there could be solutions to fix this problem. Like, I mean, they own Fandango. Why not just like have a thing where like,
or Fandango owns them?
Yeah. But like, why not have a thing where you have a ticket, you have a right to say like something about the movie, but it's going to lead to another problem where like you might not have the ticket, like, so you can't have your voice be heard. And it's just,
yeah,
it leads
to, why can't it be an online thing?
It leads a problem to people having a reliance on Rotten Tomatoes. Like, they rely, like, Rotten Tomatoes relies on a movie's success. If a movie is badly reviewed on Rotten Tomatoes, that movie's gonna flop. Guaranteed. So, like, it's a double-edged sword, really.
I mean, I've never really seen it, Rotten Tomatoes, as, like, really being there for, like, a movie succeeding. I've only seen it as, like, you know, just a review site. Like, to express your opinions about this movie.
Yeah.
Whether you're a verified critic or not. Like, that's all I've seen it as. I've never seen it as, like, oh, if this... These movies have to have good reviews. Like, I've never seen it like that.
Well, here's the thing. And it's also, like, with the critics being out of touch. Like, the audience, like, some audiences will like a movie, like Power Rangers, and give positive reviews. But the critics will give bad reviews, and the movie will flop because of those critics.
That's the thing. Like, most movie critics are, like, either very biased, like, they're not thinking of it like, from a cinematic standpoint, but they're thinking of it, like, personally.
Yeah.
Which is not the way to be a critic.
Yes.
'Cause your role as a critic is to think of what's best for that business or that product.
Yes.
For the people that are purchasing that product.
Exactly.
That is the role of a critic. These critics are out of touch, as you say, because they're quote unquote wise men that see their opinions as better. Well, than everyone else.
It's not just old wise men. It's also like, just like feminist propaganda and stuff. Okay, this is going to my next topic about like how they could have improved the film.
Oh boy!
And talking about like a better film that I have also seen, Anita Battle Angel. Okay, so the marketing of the film of Captain Marvel, put more emphasis on her being a woman as opposed to her being a hero. They literally had a tagline in the film where, like, it's put her, and then, like overshadowed, like, it, like, showed the rest of the title saying, a hero. Like,
wait, what?
Yeah, that was in one of the trailers.
I mean, I don't think
her a hero.
I don't think that I could, take that. It's like, oh, she's the big hero that is a woman. It's empowering. I never really took it like that.
Well,
yeah.
It doesn't just extend to that. It also extends into the how they did the script. So, like I mentioned before with the whole, like, sexism parts where they were like, you know why it's called a cockpit, right? And the whole, you should smile more. Like, there was like whole parts that was just basically pandering to the film. It doesn't create a strong character, in my opinion. like having the actions like way more like show way more than having just a man come in and just be like, oh, hey, sexy. Like, it doesn't tell you her as a character. It just shames you. But this is also going into like how they market the film toy wise. You know how many toys they have right now for Captain Marvel? Not that much action figures, but instead dolls. Yeah, like
that.
For a movie that is right. supposed to be this feminist uprising or something like that, most of the toy line is consistent of dolls and some role play toys. No, like extensive action figure lines. Like what Spider-Man or Black Panther did. No, like Nerf guns or anything like that. It's mostly just Barbie dolls.
Like, that is a little weird.
And my problem is, why can't, like, they're basically out of touch. They don't know, like, are they trying to, like, cater to, like, females in the way that is, like, oh, we know that girls don't actually play with action figures. Like, it's not leading anywhere. You're only making the conception that females don't want to play with action figures. They don't want to see a movie, a female superhero movie.
I think that the product design team is certainly a bit far away from the rest of it.
Yeah.
The marketing. As for like the whole doll thing, well, I mean, I can honestly see, because like half the time dolls are just like almost the exact same as action figures.
Well, some
like, at the end of the day, and like most of the action figures they make too of like are just like kind of shit anyways. At the end of the day, I don't know if like the figures are very telling. But I don't know. When it comes down to the marketing, I never really found anything too bad when it came to it, because I feel that it's okay. I personally am not offended if the movie does come out and shows that it's trying to be something new in the form of, oh, we're having a woman superhero, right?
Yeah.
It's like, I'm not really bothered by that. Yeah. Because
it's just more the execution on how they did it. So,
yeah. I mean, it wasn't all that. I don't think it was nearly as obnoxious as other campaigns for female characters. Like, at least I didn't get bugged by it at all.
Yeah. That's. But at the same time, like, yeah, the movie itself is definitely different from how it's being marketed.
Yeah,
like that's how every product is. Like the marketing tries to hype you, basically.
Yeah,
well, but they also throw a lot of things out that don't really represent that product.
Yeah, but here's my complaint about like how it is compared to Anita Battleangel. So, like I mentioned before, she doesn't really have that much, like, weak moments. Like, I mentioned that, like, she doesn't show that much emotion. Well, that's actually a lie. She does show some emotion, but it's mostly, like, of anger. She doesn't show emotion of, like, smiling or trying to be human. It's only around, like, when she's around, like, other characters that she does. Like one of the female characters, like the little girl, for example.
Yeah, that's the thing is, like, she was only emotional when she met her former friend, or that her friend that she forgot.
I mean, yeah, but it was also in the fact that she'd been trained as a soldier for what
at least she could
remember as her life.
Yeah.
So, like, not being this, like, happy-go-lucky, emotional person, like, I felt that she did have a lot of... I felt that her personality was a lot more subtle. Like, she didn't have to be open, super bubbly, vibrant, that she kind of brought that other sort of, other sort of personality to the table. You know, she was confident, and sure, she had an air of smugness, but it was because, you know, she was a soldier. She was watching what she was doing, aware of her surroundings. So yeah. I feel like it.
Yeah,
I feel like
yeah.
It definitely. It added. I think it added to it overall. It was like a different, because there's only so many ways they can write these superheroes, right?
Yeah,
so that's
right.
Why I kind of feel like it added a bit to it.
Yeah, but compare this to like Anita Battle Angel. In Anita, when you first see her in the film, she's like basically this darling. She's like really cute. She like smiles. She's like, she basically like acts like an anime girl. She's really expressive. And throughout the course of the film, she develops into a much more serious character. And she starts like crying and all this stuff. Like you feel the emotions as like, you feel that she grew as a character throughout the entire movie.
It isn't Alita, an anime anyway.
Yeah, technically,
like that's the thing that really put me off is that her eyes like,
well, it's like, actually funny,
it was really
that,
weird.
It's actually funny that this character, that Anita, is actually a robot, and she shows way more emotion than an actual human being in Brie Larson. It's actually really funny. But what makes Anita character so different was that you feel her struggle for the entire film. You see her grow as a character. Like, during one of the scenes, she becomes this hunter warrior. That's what they call the bounty hunters. She ends up going into this bar full of hunter warriors, and she starts acting like she knows how to fight. She's like, come on, fight me! And then this giant like tank like monster like robot comes in and fights her. She ends up losing all of her limbs outside of one of her arms, and she could still fight that like monster off, but only barely. She had to have help by like her father and some guys with a couple of dogs. It shows vulnerability. Like, even though
I mean, like, Captain Marvel got captured in, like, the first, like, good, like, early part of the movie.
But she also escaped really easily.
I don't think it was, like, particularly easy. I mean, again, it's kind of a moment where it's, like, I feel like the struggle, it doesn't need to be the entirety of the movie, because I mean, if we remember back, I don't know, I feel like it's never been a matter of like, oh, you know, she hasn't struggled, so she hasn't really had like a good character development. I feel like the fact that she was journeying around trying to figure out who she was at the same time as dealing with all the different conspiracies and various like things that were happening around her were kind of enough to build her up as a character.
Yeah.
It's like, it's kind of honestly, like, you don't have to just beat the shit out of a character to make them into something, to make them into who they are. You can do it in different alternate ways. And Captain Marvel being vulnerable through her memories and her mind speaks a lot more, like, interesting to her character than just, oh, you know, she got physically beat up.
Yeah, that actually was a little bit interesting, that instead of like physical development, they make her have like mental development.
Because it's like, the, you know, we've had that, like, almost every other Marvel movie is a character getting like the ever living shit kicked out of them, and then they gotta get back up, right?
It's the entirety of Dragon Ball.
Like, yeah, there's the Dragon Ball. I honestly think the only other movie that, the only other, like, differentiating than that shtick is, like, with Ant-Man, where he's kind of dealing with his place in society over, like, getting the shit kicked out of him. right? So I kind of like it when it mixes up the formula.
By the way, fucking Ant-Man and Wasp, nothing memorable. That's my review of that.
I haven't seen that the movie, worst. So I don't know what, like,
It was okay. I don't think it was that bad.
I like the Pino.
It's actually funny because I haven't seen, because I didn't see those, I didn't see the first Ant-Man either, but,
I did. I thought it was funny, actually. The fights.
I thought Ant-Man's are not really, they aren't the breakout movies for sure, but they're pretty good.
Yeah.
There's not a whole lot to the MCU I don't like, but, save for like a couple of the earlier movies that kind of don't do things too well, but
yeah. The MCU is definitely doing a lot better pleasing than the fucking DCU, so.
Yeah. But my complaint is that, like, you don't have to be pandering to tell a good story. And when, like, for example, they do pander,
but
they should go all out of the way. Like, I will, even though I said bad things about the 2016 Ghostbusters, at least that toy line didn't actually, like, focus on dolls, and they mostly focused on action figures.
I mean, when it comes down to pandering, I think it's, like, a really annoying subject to talk about, because we're in a point where media is trying to evolve, and the fact that when something gets added now in terms of adding diversity, it's always considered forced diversity or pandering. And it's like, if we can just get over that hump and not see it as that, then is it really like pandering?
Well,
yeah, like Thor isn't, then, like, it is, it's hard, like Thor, but is it pandering to males? Like, yeah. Like, tell me, in Ragnarok, did you not get like an absolute testosterone adrenaline rush when they played, like, you know, when they played
Immigrant Song,
and he, like, all powered up? Like, you know, look at it from the split perspective of that being kind of like a male pandering, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know. I see it as being able to let people take indulgence in this whole thing.
Yeah.
I think Ghostbusters is a poor example of trying to get over that hump because it was written very poorly.
Yeah.
However,
yeah,
I think Captain Marvel's, honestly, I think it's a better example, because it's like, I'm thinking now, like, so many people can have that same feeling. Like, you know, you have Black Panther, right? And how important that was for the colored communities being able to see that hero, right?
Yeah.
Representing.
Yeah.
Like,
well,
you know,
well, it became more popular than it should have. Like,
yeah.
Like, people blew it way out of proportion, is the thing.
Well, but my problem with it is, I don't have a problem with, like, representation and diversity as a concept. I don't. Like, I think it's important. But the thing is, when people are shoving it down your throat and they're shaming you for it, like, if you don't like this, you're racist, sexist, misogynist, whatever.
Well, yeah.
Like, that defeats the whole purpose of it, and people, like, hate it. Like, they don't like that, and it leads to more division. That's what I don't like.
Yeah. I know, but I feel like that's such a select niche of people who shame. Because, like, you know, I remember when Titans came out, and when people were saying that, you know, Starfire looked like absolute crap in her costume design. They were about to snap up and say, oh, well, are you guys just racist? But then a whole bunch of the black cosplaying community came out and stood up against it and said, no, like, this is bad.
Yeah.
So I don't know really if, like, not liking something, I never feel that, like, pressure. You know, like, I didn't think it was a perfect movie, like, Black Panther, but, you know, at the end of the day, I feel like it was pretty good. But there are people who blow shit tons of things out of proportion. Like, there's people who think Dragon Ball is the best anime.
Dragon Ball Z.
You know, those people will blow things out of proportion at all. It's like, oh, if you don't like Dragon Ball Z, you're not a real anime fan. Like,
oh, yeah.
Those people exist.
That's the thing.
It's just a problem with mentality.
The elitist are the problem with any fucking product, any kind of franchise. It's the elitist that shouldn't even be looked at to represent a whole product.
Yeah.
Well, what I'm basically saying is that the whole controversy, like, overblown and basically justified, like, a negative reaction when it shouldn't have. They could have easily avoided it, but they didn't, and it's hurting the movie because of it.
Yeah. Anyways, do you have final thoughts on this?
Well, I'm just gonna say, why didn't Anita Battle Angel get a toy line? Because there was this whole thing where, like, there was Mortarball in the film. Like, that could have easily been a perfect thing to have as a toy line.
Do you want
to talk about the movie? Oh, yeah, it sucks.
No, I was gonna say, like, did you want to spoil the ending for Alita Battle Angel?
No.
Because
watch it.
Because from what I gathered from what you said.
Okay. There's this one part.
Is that it's very open. It's very open.
Ending. I will say that it does have one of the worst. It has the worst cock tease in any movie I've seen. It ends the movie when, like, she was about to face the final boss or something. I'm not going into full detail about it. And then they cut right to her eye, and then credits. Yeah.
I mean, Captain Marvel kind of ended kind of... I mean, it's known...
I think.
Yeah, it ended...
Oh, the secret ending.
My weird thing about it was the pager. How they connected the pager to contacting Nick or contacting Captain Marvel again.
Yeah,
I found that funny. But it was already known that she was gonna turn up for Avengers Endgame.
Wait, she is.
Fuck! Spoilers!
Holy fuck! This
oh yeah, people are actually outraged that she's wearing makeup in the latest trailer for Avengers Endgame.
Why?
Oh,
yeah.
Like I said, vocal minority.
Yeah.
But yeah, we talked about a lot today.
Oh yeah.
So you want to close things out?
People are probably gonna hate me because I said bad things about their sacred movie, but I don't care. I just voiced my own opinion, and that's the whole point about brainwashing. It's about keeping those brains fresh and think alike, have an open mind.
Yeah,
not think alike, have an open mind.
So what we learned about this is that Nintels hates everything good, and that Nintels ruined the sponsorship with us for NordVPN. So
I hate women, and I ruined any sponsorship chances.
And I still got sponsorships, baby.
It's okay. We have Poptimus.
But no, like... yeah, we would love to hear all of your opinions in the comments about like any topics that we talked about today, and yeah, like we will see you in the next episode.
Goodbye.
I am
Batman.
Would you like a glass of wine?
I see you in 2 minutes.
I think I want to make love to you.
I have to come back in 2 minutes, okay?
I am Batman. I am Batman. I am Batman.
God, give me.
I see you in 2 minutes.